Good morning and a warm welcome from your hosts at Grant Thornton and Mills and Reeve for this year's Cambridgeshire Limited. Normally, I'm now the only thing between you and a hearty breakfast. Instead, I find myself presenting to this screen, wondering if anyone is listening. About the only thing I have in common with Donald Trump, I think you'll find. So this year, things will be different. If we can turn to the agenda, please. We will have a look at what the local economy versus national picture is telling us, and James Brown will be presenting that. We then have a piece on business resilience from Stephen Hamilton at Mills and Reeve, and then we'll have a really interesting panel discussion, which will be hosted by Hazel Platt, but with really great speakers, which include Ian Northen, Nicholas Bewes, and Matt McLoughlin. Please do submit questions via the chat box as we go through this presentation, and then also during the Q&A later. We will have you away in an hour, so if we can keep your attention for that period, I'd really appreciate it. We have no planned fire drills today, so if anything happens in your own premises or house, then you'll have to take care of yourself. So we've been in unprecedented times. We started the last 12 months in a really strong shape, and since then we've had lockdowns, furlough, sea bills. We now have Brexit to come, Biden to come, and further COVID-19 uncertainty. Over to you, James, to unravel this.
Thanks, Darren. Morning, everybody. As Darren says, we're doing things a little bit differently this year. We're given all the change and the fast pace of that change. We wanted to bring along some live data, some real-time data, to help us all understand a little bit more of where we are, certainly benchmarking us against the rest of the country. And we're going to split that into three parts. The first one being around funding, the second one about business confidence, and then the third one about vulnerability. So if we move to the next slide, please. There are three main, or can we move the next slide, please? I'm hoping we can move the next slide. Yeah, here we go. Right. There are three main areas of funding people have reached out for, excluding the VAT deferment. The first one being furlough. Now, lots of busy slides, but let's try and interpret these. The thing to concentrate on here is the orange line, which basically shows the relativity of each region in the percentage of people that they furloughed within the workforce. You can see the East there is just over 14%. So we furloughed 1 in 7 of our colleagues. That compares favorably against certain regions, London and the Southeast, you'll see are the largest, and also in percentage terms compares favorably against the West Midlands. But a theme you'll see in these slides is the East Midlands as a region and Yorkshire seem to be faring better than we are. No rhyme or reason for that necessarily, just benchmarking against the other regions in the country. If we go to the next slide, please. The next slide is about the big lending, sea bills. And you'll see here, again, the East is highlighted in absolute numbers, in absolute terms, the East, and for these purposes, the East is Cambridgeshire, Norfolk, Suffolk, and Essex. The East has borrowed £1.4 billion pounds under the sea bill scheme. Now, it's a number. We all need to think about how we're going to pay it back. But again, relatively to other regions in the country, that's more than places like East Midlands, Yorkshire. In this case, it's also more than the West Midlands, which surprised me a little bit. I think after doing years of these limited events and looking at the data going back 19 years in some counties, we are a fairly resilient and robust region in a downturn. And so this data surprised me a little because we are a mixed economy. And at the end of the day, one of those sectors in this region that always proves strong in a downturn is the food sector. People have to eat. It's an essential. So I was a little bit surprised, but it's not disproportionately worrying, but yes, that figure of 1.4 billion up till the end of August is something to muse on. If we go to the bounce back loan scheme, the next slide, please. quite simply and rather spookily, exactly the same pattern across the regions. This is obviously the loan scheme up to 50,000, but you'll see if we went back to the previous slide, absolutely the same pattern region by region. So that's the extent of the funding that we've taken from the government, as I say, apart from VAT deferment. If we now move on to business confidence, next slide and one further on, please. If we now move forward to, yes, the next slide being around cash flow. Can we move to the next? Yeah, here we go. Again, a busy slide. Let me interpret this for you. These slides, again, the East is based on Cambridgeshire, Norfolk, Suffolk, Essex. And this data was produced by the government. Government data produced from a questionnaire or a report from the 10th to 23rd of August on the basis none of us are on holiday. We might as well fill in a survey. The government got 5,300 responses. So it's a very, very robust and credible survey. First question was, how much cash have you got? And you'll see there that despite the fact there were 5,300 respondees around the country, the numbers are pretty consistent. The East there is again flagged. I think probably the main theme out of this is if you concentrate on the left-hand side, where you don't want to be. So the bold orange is you've got less than three months or less cash flow in the business. The East is actually out there against some of the other regions, only slightly, not too worryingly, but we are ahead of many of the pack. And so I suppose what does that tell me? Something completely obvious being watch out for your debtors. Certainly, we have to be wary of businesses under at risk at the moment. I always say to clients, we're coming up to halfway through a quarter, coming up to a rental quarter in late December. If you're worried about a business, if you're worried about a customer, make sure they pay before the rent's due. The next slide is quite simply one of business confidence being asking those 5,300 companies, what's your business risk of insolvency? And actually, this is pretty positive. And I think, given where we all were in April, I'd have taken this. Again, remarkable consistency across the 5,300 companies across the country. But actually, the East compares pretty favorably. You'll see, you want to be in the orange for this chart. And if you add up the bold and pale oranges, 82% of businesses in the East felt they had low or no risk of insolvency. Now, that may sound like a pretty negative thing to be excited about, but again, if you look back to how we felt in April and May, that's not bad. Interestingly, again, Yorkshire and East Midlands seem to favour pretty well. Probably the most worrying thing is London is off the pace. You'll see London, the confidence in London is about 5% short of where everybody else is. That's probably a key theme from that slide. If we go on to the next slide, consumer confidence, retail spending. There are two themes in this slide. For me, if you stick with the orange line to start with, that is the proportion of retail spending achieved over the internet. And not surprisingly, you will see that line goes a bit ballistic in the months of main lockdown. So in May, June time, sales on the internet contributed about 33% of overall spending. Having looked at or heard the number of knocks at my door, I can reliably inform you that South Norfolk delivered about 3% of that. So not surprising that everybody was on the internet when they couldn't go out to the shops. But I suppose the key question there is how much of that behaviour will stick? A bit like our new business practices and having these sorts of events and how we interact with colleagues, how much of this new behaviour will stick? And on that, a very real economic thought of how much of that is going to be a further kick and difficulty for those retailers on the high street. The second key theme from this slide, can we go back, please? The second key theme from this slide is if you compare June, July, August in this year, 2020, versus the same months in 2019, the consumer has actually spent more. Now, clearly that could be around, we've all had perhaps weeks we didn't spend on holidays, we've all had more cash we haven't been spending on petrol. But clearly the consumer hasn't been stashing it away thinking there's a rainy day coming. Is that a concern? Depends on next year's economy. But that level of spending year on year, given the situation we find ourselves in, the consumer isn't stashing it away. Indeed, if you look at the residential housing market, that's very buoyant at the moment. Again, the consumer feeling confident. Only time will tell. If we move on to the next slide, please. So, understanding the impact and recovering from COVID. Next slide, please. Grant Thornton, here at Grant Thornton, we have prepared an index, a vulnerability index. And what is that based on? It's based on a basket of measures, not just financial. It's based on a basket of measures to assess how vulnerable are the various regions of the UK and how quickly could they recover. And you'll see there that basket of measures are demographics, the people in a particular region, the economy, health, financial vulnerability of people and business, place, and by that we mean location, infrastructure, services, and also social care. So we've put all those measures together to come up with a vulnerability index to see which regions are more vulnerable to what we're going through at the moment than others. And the next slide, if we can go on to that, please. The next slide starts bringing home some key messages. This shows East Anglia, or the East. You'll see that the darker the colour, the more worrying it is. The lighter the colour, the better it is. And I think this brings alive the dichotomy of Cambridgeshire, which is more pronounced than just about any county in the country. Because what you see there is, we know that Cambridge and South Cambridgeshire is in the lowest 20% risk of economic downturn from what's happening at the moment, in the 20% least depressed areas in the country. And yet 30 miles up the road towards the Fens in the east of Peterborough, that area is in the most depressed 20% of the country and most vulnerable to what's happening at the moment. Just 30 miles away. And that really is a key theme when you compare Cambridgeshire to other counties around the country. Both ends of the spectrum. Other messages in there, Bedford, the area around Bedford is exposed to some vulnerability, as is Norfolk. Now, you've got to remember some of the themes or the measures, the baskets that are used, things like how far is it to your nearest food shop, quality of broadband. Now, living in South Norfolk as I do, I'm quite pleased to now have Channel 4. So it's not surprising that broadband probably brings down Norfolk in the measures. If we go on to the next slide, please. And so just bringing that even more alive, a bit more detail, you'll see green is good. And so most of the East, Norfolk, Essex, Suffolk, Cambridgeshire, most of it scores pretty well. The one where we have some problem is that place basket. And you'll see at the bottom of the slide, the various place index factors that are taken into account. Now, surprisingly, I suppose Cambridgeshire has still got some orange, but that again is back to the fact we've got two ends of the spectrum within Cambridgeshire itself that sort of net out to provide that slightly more alarming orange. Next slide, please. And so this is the final slide. Again, busy, but let me interpret it for you. Vulnerability versus recovery. So the horizontal axis is the vulnerability index, and the vertical axis is the recoverability index. So where you want to be is in the top left-hand corner, and you'll see places like Hampshire, Surrey, Buckinghamshire, well up there. It's surprising to see Devon, but there we go. Cambridgeshire is okay. I think we'd find Cambridge itself would be well up in the upper left-hand corner. But again, we have to take on board the message of Cambridgeshire has a very mixed picture under COVID. And that probably for the county is the key theme of this data. As we look to recover, how do we ensure the whole county recovers and not just Cambridge? Something to think about perhaps for the panel. That's it from the data. I hope that's been of interest to you. And now I'd like to hand over to Stephen Hamilton from Mills and Reeve to talk about business resilience.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, James. So in early 2020, prior to COVID, Mills and Reeve conducted extensive research with its clients and contacts. And the market research was designed to test amongst our clients and contacts what it was that they felt made their business more resilient. We wanted to identify certain themes so as to try and build a consistent picture of how it is that businesses go about building resilience. And as I think you can see from the slides that James has just been running through, that resilience is something that runs through our economy. And so we wanted to know what it is that enabled people to do that. We didn't realise in early 2020 what was about to come. So it did make the research even more timely than we thought it was going to be. And there on the slide, you can see the five key factors that really came out of our research quite strongly. So the first, in relation to upskilling teams, this was about businesses increasing their team members' understanding so as to enable them to adapt to changing situations. It was very much a people thing. It was about increasing the investment in people and then increasing those people's knowledge and abilities to be able to adapt to changing situations. It was definitely a people play was the most important factor when businesses were building resilience. Secondly, there on the list was strategic flexibility. So this wasn't necessarily about changing moment to moment. This was about having an ability to adjust the focus of a business so as to be able to interpret what was happening and thereby adapt the overall business strategy so as to maintain the changing direction of the marketplace. This was about setting a strategic direction for the business, but then being able to adapt and flex that strategy. The next factor on the list was adapting to change. This was far more about being reactive to things that were happening at that very moment. Strategic flexibility was more about the proactive change. This was more about being nimble as things did change so as to enable the changing situation. And we found this reactive change was something business leaders in the UK were generally pretty good at and pretty comfortable with. They're used to change, used to being ready to adapt. That entrepreneurial spirit that we have so much in the UK, this was seen as a real strength when it came to enabling businesses to build that resilience, to prepare for the unknown, to make headway where they can in a changing environment. Some of the key changes that we experienced as a result of COVID, the restrictions on movement, the ability of people to trade, the job retention schemes, these were all things that people had to adapt to the change as it hit them, rather than necessarily the strategic flexibility mentioned previously, which was more an overall ability to be flexible and adapt the strategy. There was also a part here for advisors to play. Obviously, we wanted to take some themes away from this as advisors and enable us to be able to advise our clients better and help our clients build that resilience with their business. This was one area where clients said that they definitely had to look for advisor help, both in relation to overall strategic flexibility, but also that day-to-day ability to adapt to the changing environment. When it came to the last two factors on the list, technology and innovation, these were all partly around the people point again, in that for technology, people were looking to the technology to enable their people to adapt quicker and to be able to work better. So the technology in terms of building resilience was all about enabling their teams, enabling their people to be able to work better, work quicker, work in a different changing environment. There's been a huge increase in people-focused technology as a result of what's happened over the last few months, and many people have been forced to innovate in the way that they work, which then brings us on to the last factor there, innovation. Generally, businesses who felt they were able to build more resilience tended to be the businesses that were excited by the prospect of innovation and the prospect of alternative solutions for doing things and innovative solutions as a way to make their businesses better. But in general, that innovation was about freeing up the time of their people to be able to enable their people to focus what matters for the business and what enables the business to perform better in the changing environment. So those were the five factors really that came out very strongly through the research we undertook. And the reason we undertook this research was both to help businesses identify what it is that enables them to build resilience so that they can focus on it, but also to enable us as advisors to be able to best know how to help our businesses and then help our clients become more resilient, so as to make sure that we can carry on having those rather pleasing statistics that James has just run through, which I'm sure many of us at the beginning of the pandemic would have taken if that was the outcome. And with that, I'll hand over to Hazel for today's panel session.
Good morning, everyone. And thank you very much, Darren, James and Stephen. So as Stephen said, now it's your chance to get involved by answering poll questions, which will come up in due course, as well as getting the opportunity to hear from our panel. So I'm delighted to be joined by three respected business leaders in the county today. So firstly, Ian Northen. So Ian trained as a chartered accountant with Robson Rhodes, later acquired by Grant Thornton, and he was a partner both there and at BDO before joining Ridgeons as finance director in 2009. He stepped into the CEO role at Ridgeons in 2016, leading the business while it appeared in the Sunday Times profit track and growth track, and then navigated the business through sale to Huws Gray in 2018. So he continues to lead the Ridgeons business in East Anglia while being a director of the overall Huws Gray Group. So they are a private equity backed builders merchant with 400 million turnover, 1600 employees and 100 sites across England and Wales. So next, Nicholas Bewes. Nicholas is Chief Executive of the Howard Group, Cambridge-based family business, which was established in 1935. The business is one of the largest regional property investment and development companies. So through Howard Capital, the group's private equity arm, the company is also a significant investor in early stage businesses, both in Cambridge and further afield. And outside of the Howard Group, Nicholas is active in the county, being a trustee of various charities, including the Cambridge Music Festival, and as one of the founding directors of Cambridge Ahead. So Nicholas has also held various roles in the Institute for Family Business, currently serving as a member of their policy committee. And finally, Matt McLoughlin. Matt is a senior investment manager at Foresight Group, a private equity investor specialising in the SME market. He's based in Cambridge and focuses on Foresight's East of England Fund. That's a £100 million fund launched in 2019, which invests in companies in the East of England region. Before joining Foresight, Matt spent 15 years advising investors and companies on M&A transactions, both at Grant Thornton and Deloitte. So good morning, gentlemen. Thank you for joining me. And to start, we are going to gauge the mood of you, our participants, with our first audience poll question, if you wouldn't mind voting, please. Thank you. So the results, gentlemen, which hopefully you can see. I'll come to you first, Ian. Do those results surprise you? And I guess interested to hear about your feelings on the future of Huws Gray Ridgeons, please.
No, I don't think they surprise me particularly. I suppose I was surprised to see so many businesses there that feel less positive now than they did earlier in the year. But I suppose for us as a business, you know, the lockdown time back in March, April was pretty terrifying, really, because like a lot of businesses, we had to close. And we didn't really know how long that was going to last. So we entered into a period of time where we shut the business down, furloughed 95% of our colleagues, not knowing when and even how we'd reopen and what that might look like. But you know, since reopening in May, the business has performed strongly. We're in a sector that's been buoyant. You know, construction's got going. Lots of people spent lots of money, thankfully, on fence panels for their garden and paint for their kitchens. So the sector, if you like, has been kind to our business. And I suppose I can see why the uncertainty weighs on people's confidence even now. Just gone into a new lockdown. Okay, there's some news of a potential vaccine, but the question is, how many times are we going to have to keep going in and out of this this lockdown scenario, and what that means for our businesses?
Yeah, and Nicholas.
Yeah, good morning. I think one of the things that, I personally, if I were voting, I would have voted, positively in that poll just now. I think one of the things that I've been most encouraged by over the recent months about both our business and our team as well, which is a much smaller team than the Ridgeons team. It's how agile and flexible we are. If you told me that we'd be out of the office working remotely for months with 24 hours notice, I wouldn't have believed you, but we and countless others did exactly that. And actually our experience was it was relatively seamless. And I wonder what it would have been like 5 years ago before we had these advancements in technology. But I think we've talked a little bit earlier about the need for resilience and the need for agility and flexibility and greater creativity and entrepreneurialism. Many people told me actually how tired they were at the start of lockdown. I'm sure we can all remember back to them. And we all put it down to being on Zoom. But I think it was also because we were having to think and operate differently, operating in different ways, different modes. So I'm actually very positive about the future. I'm very positive. I think it's taught us that we can adapt. We're good at adapting and evolving as businesses, as individuals. I think the real estate industry as a whole has been probably pretty slow to evolve and embrace change. But we're certainly seeing that is changing on fast, actually, on the back of what's going on. And I think from the Howard Group's perspective, we see opportunities ahead, although we're also very aware there are some big challenges that we're going to face over the coming months. And perhaps we'll come on and talk about that a little bit later.
Thank you. And Matt, I guess briefly, if you've anything to add in terms of, I guess, your view on level of positivity.
Yeah, well, at Foresight, we've invested in about 100 SMEs across the UK at the moment. And I think the comparison to April, for me, looking across the portfolio, is that this time, at least we kind of know what we're doing a bit. So you know, April was a time of running around, watching government updates every day to see what the new rules were going to be, trying to adapt to those, share that information. And I think that the enormous uncertainty that existed then is different now, and people have kind of, you know, reset to some extent and can look forward, which is probably one of the reasons why people are feeling a bit better than they did before. That the risk, I suppose, is that we need to keep the energy up, and I think the longer people are restricted in the way that they are at the moment, the harder it gets. So this kind of emerging good news, I think, is very timely, because you know, people can only be restricted for so long, in my view, and the sooner we, you know, we get out and creating and doing things that we like doing, the better.
Thank you. And I guess sticking with that positivity and touching a little bit, Nicholas, on something you just said. So I guess it's easy to feel pessimistic, but actually, I think you said you've learnt and we've adapted in the way in which we've been working. So maybe if each of you, positive thing that you've learnt in the way that you as business leaders are running your businesses now because of the what you've had to do. I guess it'd be interesting to hear that.
Do you want me to go first?
Yeah, go for it. Yeah, thank you. Because I know you touched on it a moment ago. So yes.
Yeah, I mean, I think that there is a confidence. I'm certainly sensing it, that there's a confidence that we can adapt and we can evolve. To some extent, we've had it forced on us. But I do see that there's a positivity around that. And I've sensed that within the Howard Group team as well, that, you know, we are out there, we're carrying on doing business, albeit in a different way. I think one of the things that we learned between the two lockdowns, when we had that period of being able to sort of get back to a degree of normality, was just the value of meeting people face to face. And you know, how great that was just to be able to see people, which of course at the moment is harder to do. So I think lots of things to be positive about, lots of reasons for optimism, I think.
Okay, and Ian, a positive impact in the way that you're working coming out of this, if there's something for you to add?
I would agree with Nicholas. I think the interesting thing for us has been how much people have realised, having been locked down in our case for 5 or 6 weeks and properly closed back into April time, how much people have realised how much they value coming to work, and yeah, they value their job for more than just the amount of money it gives them at the end of the month. And actually, it's had a curiously positive effect on employee engagement as a result, because people are, understandably in many ways, grateful to have a job at all, given the alternative, but also understand the value of getting out of the house in our case, because most of our people don't work at home. So that's been certainly true. And I think, like Nicholas, our business has been forced to adapt, and it breeds confidence in people's ability to do that. So that's another positive for us.
Thank you. So I guess if we move back to another audience question, sort of flowing on from that, thinking about how our people are working in our businesses, please. Oh, hopefully. There you go. Thank you. Okay, so, and I think that's probably not a surprising statistic, but Ian, you just touched on it a moment ago. For your business, I know that working at home for the majority of your people isn't a possibility. So I don't know if you want to comment on that, and particularly maybe the relationship that the business is having with its employees on the back of having to adapt how we work.
Yeah, so when our business is, the question on the screen was about office space, but for our business, of the 1,600 or so people, I would say 1,500 are based in our branches and therefore have to physically go to work in order to serve customers. And what that's meant for us is a number of ways of putting new measures in place to make things safe for people, all the obvious stuff you'll see in other shop type environments. And I think, generally speaking, our people have been very positive and thankful that we've done everything we need to do. So we don't, all this talk that I hear from other businesses about remote working hasn't really affected us in the same way. I mean, some of our head office teams are more remote now, but there isn't, culturally for us, there's a bit of a desire to stand shoulder to shoulder with our colleagues at the front end and therefore make more of an effort to come into the office, although we're blessed with lots of space per person, so it's not like we're in a high risk environment and we're not traveling by train into London. So I think that this is definitely depends what industry you're in and where you're based as to precisely how things will be affected. But I've also seen people I know that have worked at home for the 6 or 7 months that we've now been like this are desperate to get back to some kind of office environment for at least some of the time, for their own kind of well-being.
And I think, Matt, I guess you're probably more in the camp of office space. So that statistic around 70% expecting to need less office space going forward. Your thoughts on what you think that does in terms of changing your relationship with employees and how that employers can embrace that change, maybe in the context of the portfolio businesses you're working with?
Yeah, it's not a surprise, as Ian said, that people are thinking in that way while their offices are stood unutilised or empty. But yeah, the important thing that has really kind of come through as a feature for me is about the relationship between people in businesses and the trust that exists right from top to bottom in organizations. So that's kind of within leadership teams and then between leadership teams and management and the rest of the people in businesses. Because I think, kind of extending a point that Ian was just making there, I think if you've got people who all kind of go to work, be it virtually or physically, for the same reason, that really focused on serving their customers or, you know, the next innovation or whatever it might be, actually where you put those people or how they work, as long as it functionally kind of operates, isn't necessarily the most important thing. Whereas if there's a culture in an organization where people do just go to work because they want to get paid at the end of the month, then some of those structural and functional things become much more important. So I think alignment and trust across organizations is much more connected into this question than we all probably realized at the start of all of this.
Yeah, thank you. And Nicholas, just moving that on a little bit, so we're thinking about engagement with our employees, and I think you talked about it. I think there is understandably a growing concern around the current situation on people's mental health and well-being, and I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on how you're tackling that in your business and the things that you're doing as a business leader and employer at the Huws Group.
Thank you. Yes, well, we don't employ, as I said earlier, huge numbers of people, but certainly what this has highlighted to us is that there is a need for us to put in place programs, policies and arrangements that do go much deeper in terms of caring for employees as individuals. I think one of the things that has been a benefit actually of what we've been going through is we've got to know each other so much better. We've to some extent shared each other's private lives when we're sitting at home on our Zoom cameras. We get to see inside each other's homes. And actually that's been quite a positive thing because we've got to know each other in a very different way. But I think there is still this sense of when you ask someone how they are, they say fine. I think what we're learning is to say, well, let's really dig into that a little bit and really ask how are you and what are some of the issues that you're facing? And as an employer, how can we help to support you through, you know, perhaps difficult times that we don't even know about that you're facing at home with family members, with wider family members who are struggling and all sorts. So it's actually, I guess as a family-owned business, we are naturally very focused on family values, on family issues. So we have been putting in place various employee assistance arrangements, things that we probably would have done, I'm sure, anyway. And I know many companies on this call will already be doing that. We've probably accelerated it. And we set up a buddy system so that we have we have informal check-in times with people, not about work, just to see how they're getting on. So yes, I think it's got us just to think a little bit more carefully and a little bit differently about employee relationships. And I really hope that that is something that is going to continue into the future, because actually I think it's a great positive.
Thank you. And Ian, I appreciate your business, as you've said, is quite different in terms of potentially the impacts this has had on your workforce. But obviously you have a lot of people. So anything you want to add to that?
Yeah, I think we've had two sets of issues, really, I guess. Here. One where people have not been in the business for a period of time and either come back from furlough, you know, or have been working at home for a long time. And that adjustment's quite difficult for people, actually. And I think we haven't experienced it, but what I can see, a real challenge coming for businesses that have had people working at home for 6 months or more and helping them back into the workplace in time. Because, you know, what we saw after even only 6 to 8 weeks was a real anxiety about coming back into the workplace, whether that was a shop or an office, because, you know, when you're at home, you're bombarded with the news and it's rarely positive, and therefore you think, well, it's a bit like chicken licking, you think the sky is falling down, and it takes a little while to adjust to that stuff. So we've had to help people through that transition quite a bit, which I think is something a lot of businesses will still have to face in the new year.
Thank you, that's helpful. So I think if we move on to another question now around funding and availability of finance, and we'll slightly change the direction of the conversation. Thank you. Okay, so I guess looking at the answers to that question, so broadly similar, secured access to all the finance or no need for additional external finance. So that might not be great news for you, Matt, but I guess thinking about that and also the presentation that we had around businesses in the East of England reporting one of the lowest rates of risk of insolvency. So Matt, I'll come to you first. Do you think that businesses in the region are more resilient than in some other areas of the country? And I suppose then extending that on, do you think there's a difference between Cambridge and other areas of the county, which seemed to be a suggestion in what we saw in James's presentation?
Yeah, as you say, great. As a funder, interesting to see that those results. It reminds me of when I was an M&A advisor at one of these events, and everybody responded that they weren't interested in doing M&A.
So
I think it's probably a combination of things, and I think one is you kind of alluded to it there, Hazel. Historically, I think when we've done these types of events, we've found that the region compared to other parts of the UK is generally a bit less geared. There's a bit less debt in businesses in general in this region than there are in some other parts of the UK, and there'll be people kind of dialed into this who will agree or disagree with that, I suppose. But I think that's probably one of the reasons, again, the kind of immediate need to quickly refinance, I suppose, is probably not as prevalent in this part of the UK as it might be in other places. I also think that the impact of some of the government schemes that have been made available has been substantial. And in some ways, there's a couple of features here. One is, I think we don't quite really know about all of the funding gaps that might exist in the region, because the furlough scheme and other kind of CBILS and other offerings are enabling businesses to, you know, to continue trading and not have to seek funding in the way that they otherwise might have to do, which is obviously a good thing. The other thing is I think that there are just anecdotally, I suppose, I hear quite a lot of stories of companies who have taken some of those government enabled schemes and potentially still have some of that cash on the balance sheet and are, you know, still kind of scanning the sort of immediate and medium term future for what might happen. So I think if you'd asked that question in April, the answer might have been a little bit more of a mixed picture. I think what we've got now is a picture where businesses have kind of taken some of the actions that they really needed to take in the early part of the year, and are now kind of taking a look at what comes next, and probably potentially not having made those decisions and the funding elements that come along with those decisions. As we see an evolution of the markets, I think we'll probably see a bit more of a separation between businesses who consider themselves to be in a really strong position and really want to strategically kind of seek to grow market share, for example, and are prepared to take a risk around new funding for that, and then other businesses who see themselves coming out of the end of some of the available schemes at the moment and are seeking funding for different reasons there as well. So it's good that the regional picture is where it is at the moment, and I think it's going to be really interesting to see where that is in another 3 to 6 months' time.
Thank you. And Nicholas, thoughts on business resilience, I guess, more than specifically the funding piece, your view on whether the region to you seems more resilient than perhaps other areas of the country, and is that what you're seeing and hearing from your conversations?
Yes, I mean, I suppose like many people, I have a sort of set of standard questions when I meet people now, and actually resilience is one of those questions. And yeah, I think it bears out exactly what we were hearing from Stephen earlier, that there is a resilience in the region. I think we all know that. Over the past few years, global turnover of Cambridge-based companies has increased significantly, and employment's been growing at similar sort of levels, 6-7% or so. I think in our property business, we've seen occupiers who have shown great resilience. In fact, talking of funding, they've been able to secure funding. They've been talking to us about their growth plans, wanting to consider how they might be able to grow over the coming years, which is all painting a very positive picture. So, but I do think, as we were hearing earlier, we are a mixed economy in the region, and it's perhaps one thing for us to be focusing on the knowledge intensive industries and some of the things that Cambridge is perhaps well known for and the region is well known for. But we've also got to remember that, you know, we've got retail, hospitality, leisure businesses, which we know are hurting, where, you know, their resilience is being severely tested. And I think it's in those areas where, you know, where we are seeing strain. And unfortunately, I think, you know, we'll continue to see that for a while. So it is a mixed picture. Not that I want to sort of rain on anyone's parade.
No, okay, fair enough. Thank you. And Ian, I'm just thinking, obviously, 100 sites across England and Wales. So you're probably best positioned maybe to give a more national picture. Anything you want to add on business resilience differences you're seeing across the country?
There are subtle differences, but they sort of ebb and flow, really. I mean, I think when we've been talking about resilience, one of the things that helps us is the geographical spread, because yeah, precisely what you say, different parts of the country experience different things. And when Wales was in its firebreak lockdown for the last couple of weeks, we can see that in our numbers, and we can start you can see stuff when different parts of the country are restricted. But I think what it comes back to is just finding new ways of dealing with the challenge, if you like, and what that's forced us to do. For us, the way we look at resilience is having a spread of customers. We just don't have a concentration of customers, because we deal with thousands, but you're not quite retail, but it's not a million miles from it. People I know that have got businesses that have found things difficult have either been because they're in a sector that's dramatically affected, like retail and hospitality, or because they've got a concentration in a particular area or on a particular group of customers that when they pull the drawbridge up, they've got no real way of responding. So I think it's just having that spread is helpful.
Yeah, thank you. And Matt, just returning to financing for a moment. So we had a question came in, sort of a pre-event question came in, which is specifically around funding. So this was from Matt Shirley at the One Group. So thank you for that, Matt. And it is a question for Matt. So whether you expect more or less limited partner investment to enter the UK PE market during 2021 on the back of the challenges of 2020. So maybe just a couple of thoughts on that would be helpful to answer that. Thank you.
Thanks, Matt. Sounds like an exam question to me. So as it stands, there's plenty of PE cash in the UK. I think that's quite well documented. The general sentiment is that investors are looking across the board for good opportunities, and have probably done less investing across the last 9 months than they otherwise would have done. The local picture is that the East of England actually is really underrepresented as far as private equity investment is concerned, and and therefore that dynamic exists even more so, I think, to some extent. As far as next year is concerned, there's a fairly well recognised view that equity investment at some stage is going to play a key role in the recovery of the UK economy. I think at the SME level, that's particularly the case, and particularly the case in regional markets where businesses who can drive the recovery of the economy are going to need not just the capital, but also the kind of strategic partnerships that comes with private equity style investment. So there's definitely a place for it, I think, and particular types of PE investment, I think, are going to perform better than others. So as I said, I think regional focus is going to be really important. I think that having a focus on environmental and sustainable features again is really, really high on the priority list of a lot of people. So funds that are looking for those types of investments, I think, are going to be really busy. And then the final thought, I suppose, just thinking while I'm talking, is that the current sort of economic situation where interest rates are particularly low and it's quite hard to find places for investors to put their capital and get a return means that equities are probably more attractive as an asset class than many other places. So, you know, LPs such as, you know, local pension funds, for example, are, you know, they're not going to be able to generate a particularly strong return for their investors through gilts and bonds and some of the other stuff that they might normally have in the mix, which probably does bring private equity up the list slightly. So a bit of a mix, but I think overall the answer to your question is probably yes. I think we should see plenty of PE across the next 12 months.
Thank you, Matt, and sorry to have put you on the spot. So I guess we're going to move on to another audience participation question, which is about looking forward, please. Interesting. Thank you for responding to that. So, Ian, coming to you first. I guess how would you have answered that, and what view are you taking in your business, and what are you seeing in the wider sector?
Yeah, I suppose for us, we were firmly in the batten down the hatches category back in April, and I remember what that felt like. But I don't like to think about it too much now because it's pretty dark. But we're firmly in the be brave category at the moment. I mean, we completed an acquisition in October, and we've got a few others in the pipeline between now and March. And that's, you know, I guess partly due to the sector we're in and the opportunity that's there for consolidation at the moment. I think there must be opportunities in pretty much every sector for businesses that are, well-funded and prepared to be brave. Equally, I don't suspect people are going to want to over-leverage themselves at the moment, because as positive as we are about, you know, vaccine opportunities and that sort of stuff, there's still some uncertainty next year. And I think it's that cautious bravery, if there is such a thing, that says, we're not being gung-ho about things. We are still turning away more acquisition opportunities than we're pursuing. And we're still being laser focused on what it is we believe works, rather than being distracted by some bright, shiny thing that might have come along. So I think what stood us in good stead is, yes, being adaptable, but equally, you know, knowing what we're good at and not allowing ourselves to be distracted, particularly at a time when there's enough distractions from daily government briefings and what have you.
Thank you. And Nicholas, your thoughts?
Yeah, I think I echo what Ian's just said. I mean, I think getting the basics right has been certainly our mantra, just making sure that we're doing all the obvious things as a business we should be doing. But having done that, and if you like, shored everything up, steadied the ship over the last months, we do look forward with confidence. There are some great opportunities out there. And that confidence is also shared by the many occupiers or prospective occupiers that we've been talking to, particularly down in South Cambridge at our emerging business park in Sawston. Some great discussions going on there, some new lettings down there, built on the back of confidence that, you know, things are looking brighter and there are opportunities ahead. So, you know, I echo actually what the poll came out and said actually about taking calculated risks. I think it's a time for us to do that and step forward boldly.
Thank you. And Matt, is the poll answer of 75% be brave, take calculated risks to invest for the future, is that resonating with what you're seeing and the conversations you're having?
I think it's brilliant. I think if I had to guess in advance, I think I probably would have expected it to be a bit more finely balanced. So it's I think it's a real positive that's how people are feeling and bodes really well. I'm sure that there's been a transition between that kind of, you know, get the basics right, batten the hatches down and go for growth, and it's shifting over time. And I think on the evidence of that, it's we're really moving towards a point in time where the regional economy will be able to, you know, to drive out of recession if that's how the leaders that have joined this this session are looking at the opportunities that are ahead of them.
Thank you. And hopefully we've had a question in from Linda Housemans on the sort of live chat, which is around if we are to build Britain back better, what does that look like for the panel? I'm assuming that the question we've just asked about be brave, take calculated investment risks in the future, I'm assuming that is a large part of how you would answer that question. But if there's anything you want to add, if I come to you first, Nicholas.
No, I don't think so. I mean, I think the only thing I would say is that this idea of taking back greater control and being confident, I mean, that it's a question that sort of resonates a little bit around the whole Brexit discussion. I know we haven't really got into that at all today, but I do think that Great Britain has got a lot to be very confident about. I think we've proved time and again that there is a great opportunity for us. There's great strength in all that we do. I think that coming out from the pandemic, it's going to be a good opportunity for us to get back onto our feet and do what we do best. And it does need, I think, good leadership at all levels. I think that speaks to us as business leaders, but it speaks also at government level. I don't want to get overly political, but you know, I think that there are a lot of things that we do need to be addressing as a nation in order to fulfil our potential going forward.
Thank you. And I think the there's final a couple question. Matt.
I was just going to say that there's a couple of really practical things I think that fit what Nicholas just said. What one is kind of the sustainability agenda, you know, all this, the kind of build back better kind of agenda. But Rishi Sunak was talking yesterday, wasn't he, about really building in environmental and sustainability features into, you know, some of the financial products that are going to be made available to support business. And I think that we've had this kind of reset, and I think bringing sustainability features across different businesses is going to be really, really important. And I think that the other point, and Nicholas and Ian and I aren't the most sort of terrific exponents of this, but I think that kind of diversity across different workplaces and across the economy, again, there's an opportunity for this sort of reset to supercharge some of these things up the agenda that were already very high on the agenda, but are fundamental, I think, now, and we've got an opportunity to focus in on some of those things more so than before.
Thank you. And any final comments you wanted to add, Ian, before I go to our final question?
No, I was thinking about actually, you know, one of the positives during the pandemic has been people pulling together in business and in the community more generally. And I think there is an opportunity when we talk about building back better to build a more socially responsible corporate world, if you like, and that's partly about the environmental stuff that Matt's talking about, but just partly about how we treat each other. And it sounds a bit utopian, but I think there's a real opportunity to do that.
Thank you. So the time has raced by, and there is one final audience question, which we'd just like to ask you, and something that we do tend to ask each year. Just it's interesting to see responses. So if we could just get that. Thank you. Pretty even spread there. So new lockdowns not causing people too many sleepless nights, but all of the other issues are things that you are worrying about and thinking about and concerned about. So unfortunately, panel, I haven't got time to ask you your answer to that question, but I would like to say thank you very much for your time, and thank you also to Mills and Reeve for their participation. I hope everyone on the session has enjoyed it and found it interesting. Maybe it sparked debate and thought for you in your businesses. As you log off, you will get a brief feedback form. So please do fill that in. Obviously, it's been a very different style of event this year. And do please get in touch if you want to continue the conversation. I'm aware there are a couple of panel questions that came in that I'm sorry, I didn't get a chance to ask the panel. Thank you very much for your time, everyone, and have a great day. Thank you. Goodbye.